Can you hear me? I tend to move away, and so I don't always get close to the speaker. First of all, thank you to Turning Technologies for the invitation and for allowing us to share some of our observations with you today. I think that most people would agree, how many clinicians in the room? Most clinicians would agree that hands-on training would be very important for the development of critical learning skills. You can teach people the things that they need to know, but until they're actually put into a situation to perform, it's difficult to assess them. And it's difficult to give them feedback on maybe things they did right or wrong. So one of the ways that we can teach critical learning skills, decision making, is actually at the bedside. It gives you the opportunity to do things. I was looking for your gives us the opportunity to do things in a hands-on way. You can assess your patient, you can decide whether or not the things you did were right or wrong. Although it's a great way to learn critical thinking skills, there is a risk for the patient. There's a risk for the practitioner who's then teaching, who's precepting the learner, because of maybe things that could go wrong. If you're at the bedside, you can correct things that are there. So even though this is probably one of the best places to get hands-on practice with critical thinking skills, it does have limitations. Some of the limitations, this is a picture of a typical neonatal pediatric intensive care unit, and I hope that what you can get from the picture is that it's a crowded place. And again, if you're clinicians, you all know that. So in this instance, you're looking at about six beds that would be set up. And in the six bed area, you would have the clinician who actually is working with the patient. And now if you had a novice, a new person in the room, you've added another body that's in the way. You have very critical babies. If you had a ventilator, if you had other pieces of equipment, all of a sudden the bedside has become very crowded, tangled with tubing. So there is the potential for a lot of error. So even though this is a great place to develop critical thinking, its space and the high acuity of the patients make it challenging, to say the least. So this pic would tell you that simulation has been used for a long period of time by multiple industries as a way of providing hands-on or the ability to do critical thinking. Let me play this for you. And so I lost. I'm going to pause it. Let's try again.
What the hell happened?
Hesitated.
May I ask why you felt little Tiffany deserved to die?
Well, she was the only one that actually seemed dangerous at the time, sir.
How'd you come to that conclusion?
Well, first I was going to pop this guy hanging from the streetlight, and then I realized, you know, he's just working out. And how would I feel if somebody come running in the gym, bust me in my ass while I'm on a treadmill? Then I saw this snarling beast guy, and I noticed he had a tissue in his hand. I realized, you know, he's not snarling. He's sneezing. Real threat.
I didn't mean to pause it. I'm sorry. And I did it.
Edward, what the hell happened?
Hesitated.
May I ask why you felt little Tiffany deserved to die?
Well, she was the only one that actually seemed dangerous at the time, sir.
Conclusion.
Well, first I was going to pop this guy hanging from the streetlight, and then I realized, you know, he's just working out. And how would I feel if somebody come running in the gym, bust me in my ass while I'm on a treadmill? Then I saw this snarling beast guy, and I noticed he had a tissue in his hand. I realized, you know, he's not snarling. He's sneezing. You know, ain't no real threat there. And I saw little Tiffany. I'm thinking, you know, 8-year-old white girl, middle of the ghetto, bunch of monsters, this time of night with quantum physics books. She about to start some shit, Zed. She's about 8 years old. Those books are way too advanced for her. If you ask me, I say she's up to something. And to be honest, I'd appreciate it if you eased up off my back about it. Or do I owe her an apology? That was a good shot, though, right?
So again, an idea of simulation, and I hope that lightened your afternoon a little bit. So that's one of the things that we do with simulation. We can teach critical thinking skills. And the take-home message from this is that you do have the ability to interact with a situation that is somewhat realistic, and then immediately after, you need to have an ability to debrief. One of the things that you can see from this, though, is that each individual had an opportunity to perform, to interact, and then each individual as to what their interaction was. Was it correct? Was it appropriate? And then you can talk about afterwards why. And so this is critical thinking in the neonatal intensive care unit. One of the things that we have available to us is that we have state-of-the-art ventilators in our laboratory for our students. Again, I mentioned the care unit is a high acuity area. You have babies that are very sick, and you have novice students who maybe haven't touched a ventilator or just played with them in the laboratory but haven't seen the baby. And again, they may actually shoot someone accidentally. Although their intention may have been well placed, they said, I put all these things together and this is what I needed to do. Not necessarily something that you want to put a baby at risk with. And so it's been proposed that the use of simulation and human patient simulators in particular is important, can help develop critical thinking skills. So the simulator that we have here is a simulator made by Lairdal. It's called Sim Newbie. She is equivalent to about a 5-pound newborn infant. She can breathe, she can not breathe, she has a pulse, she doesn't have a pulse. She can do anything that you program her to do. And then the students have to respond. So we've developed mechanical ventilation scenarios that we can run our students through. And the mechanical ventilation scenarios go from troubleshooting the initiation of mechanical ventilation, troubleshooting things that have gone wrong with mechanical ventilation, terminating, changing mechanical ventilation based on the things that you do. And we assess our students with them. So I think you get an idea that we can do it in the laboratory. This is a room that was made vacant by Hurricane Ike in Galveston that we actually were able to turn into a simulation laboratory. This was the old pediatric intensive care unit. It was a room that was used for ECMO. So it's a bit bigger room, and it accommodates most of our equipment, and it can accommodate a couple of students. I think one of the things that you can gather from the room is that this would be great if you're teaching small groups of students. This is great if you have, and ideally simulation works best if you're using 4 to 6 students and maybe one instructor. To do more than that truly limits the ability for simulation and it limits the ability of the student to learn. But again, it presents a problem for you. It presents a problem if you have a large class. Our class isn't very large. We have a class of about 20 students. But even at that, from a labor-intensive portion, if we wanted to do this right, we'd have to do the simulation in groups of 4, no more than 4 to 6, so you're running 4 simulations for each of the students. Ideally, it would be best if they each had, you know, you could make it easier and do them all at one time, but then you need to get, thank you, sorry. I'll remember to stand behind the podium. I tend to move around a lot. You need to get multiple faculty to be able to run the simulations. You need to get multiple simulators, and the cost escalates. The cost of the simulator is a newbie is about $25,000. The cost of the other equipment, our ventilator here is about a $14,000 piece of equipment. So to have all of these things in 4 different stations immediately becomes labor intensive and costly. Can you provide some of the same experiences at lower cost and then do more about evaluating student responses? And I think the answer is yes, but again, the nature of this picture was to again show you this is 6 students that we have. And it becomes very crowded. Now we've added a radiant warmer that the baby is lying in, the ventilator is in the room, and some students that are up front can actually get the hands-on experience. They're running the case, they're doing things. The students that are in the background are watching. They can contribute. They can say, I think you need to do this. And at times they take turns with doing things, but you don't always get feedback. You know, this young lady was really upset by some of the things that she saw and was raw emotion that she was dealing with. This young lady really wasn't doing much. She kind of hung back. And in part of a debriefing, I might be able to talk to them, ask them, you know, why were you standing back? What were you doing? But you don't always really get an idea of what they were thinking. Is there a way that we can now get the benefit of simulation to enhance critical thinking and get all of these students engaged? And I think that the answer is yes. One of the things that we've done is we've used the audience response system to try to work with this. In this semester and in the previous semester, we've designed a total of 5 different ventilator scenarios. For the project that we were working on, we only worked on 3 of those ventilator scenarios where we were assessing our students in a pre and post fashion. The pre-test was these students in their training have all received information about mechanical ventilation. They've received information about assessing patients. They just haven't gone out in the clinic and done it. They haven't had the hands-on experience. They have the cognitive knowledge to be able to put things together. They just haven't had the practice with it. So in this semester, we decided to try to implement the use of simulation to give them that hands-on training before they actually went into the clinic, using these mechanical ventilation scenarios that we've described. We only had 3 of the scenarios, and in the pre-post testing that we did, we divided our class of 20 into 3 groups, 3 teams of 4 to 6 students per team. And then they were going to be allowed to do the simulation live, much like the video that you saw earlier where they're actually participating. There's the noise, there's the gunshots from other people shooting, there's alarms. They can try to decide whatever they're doing in the simulation. They work together as a team to say, I need to do these things for the baby, and you have that one response. The other 2 teams who aren't actually doing the simulation are sitting outside in the classroom, and they get still pictures with information that would have been the simulation. Here's baby, here's the monitor, here's the information that you get. And so you've broken the simulation down into steps, pictures at a time, and give them the opportunity to make decisions at that period of time. And then after the simulation, we debrief both groups. The live sim was, back up a minute. This room that you see back there was the room that you saw where our simulation was. So the live simulation is going on in the room back here. The groups in here are actually seeing just clips of the simulation, and they have their clickers so that they can respond. You're given a picture, you're given a blurb that's a scenario. These are the things that you see when you walk in the room. You're doing it in the absence of noise because you don't have the alarms that are going on, you don't have the other condition. As we move through, one of the things that we're envisioning doing is instead of just doing screenshots, that they could actually have video of the simulation, which would add something. It adds the noise element, it adds the live portion of it. One of the limitations to that, again, are screens and just the display technique. So we did better by projecting just stills, and it slows things down. And it's a work in progress, so we're going to be playing with those. I'll show you shortly some of the data that we look at. The simulation is finished, the live simulation is finished, and these students have gone through their turning point looking at the simulation. And now we debrief. We debrief with just the stills and the feeling that the folks had in the live simulation. Why did you do these things? What was the answer? What could you have done better? And we think that that's definitely helped in critical thinking. And so now let me share with you some of the data that we've acquired this semester. And so I mentioned to you that we had 5 cases, and we just randomly numbered them 1 through 5. They were very similar in their presentation. The way the baby would present, the data looked the same, but one was an accidental extubation, so the baby would have been desaturated, and you'd look for different things. One was actually an accidental right main stem intubation where the endotracheal tube would have shifted into the wrong place. Data would have presented the same, but you had to assess for that. One was a pneumothorax. So again, baby presented in similar ways, but they had to capture the data. And so the three cases we have, these case one, three, and four, the number is just how we numbered them. And here what we're looking at is pre and post data. And so when we say simulation, that was the performance of the group that was actually running the simulation. 4 to 6 students in the room, running the scenario, getting the data, and responding as a team. And so remember that in the pre-condition, they've never seen the cases before. They've had enough cognitive information where they could have assessed things, they could have done what they needed to do. They just really haven't put it all together. This is the beginning of putting it all together, which is kind of what would happen if you're out in the clinic anyway. This is, you've learned these things, go out in the clinic and now get some practical experience. And the difference between simulation and ARS, the simulation are the guys that are running the live sim, the performance on ARS is the average of the entire group. One of the nice things about the clickers that we use is that you can collect anonymous data. Well, we thought instead of collecting anonymous data, we've assigned the clickers to each of the students and to each of the teams. So we have the team performance, and then we have data that says, these are the people that were in the simulation. The picture that I showed you of the young lady who had her face covered, you know, if you wondered about that, is that emotion going to be enough that keeps you from performing accurately? The other individual who is hanging back in the crowd, if in the simulation, would she have been contributing, or is she weaker? So it's nice to be able to collect that data. When they're doing this out here in the classroom using the clickers, we are collecting the data, and we're collecting the data of team performance. Does that follow? And so let's look at some of the data in the pre-condition. And what we see is that they did miserable. The first two, these are two different teams in the pre-condition, and so their scores are a little bit less than 10% in the bit of decision making. And one of the things that they're distracted by is some of the stuff that you would have heard in the first Men in Black video. When things are loud, when you have things that are moving quickly, that can be pretty rough on you. It's hard to make appropriate decisions. Even though you may have all the information that you need, that can slow you down somewhat. In the third group, because again, remember these are separated by time. So we did this in 1 week. This would have been a week to 2 weeks later that they did the next case. This was a week or 2 weeks later. So in this first pre-case, they're not doing all the sims at one time. They're separated by a little bit of time, and they're getting used to doing simulation. They know that one of them is going to get to go in the simulator, and they're going to play with the baby, and the case is going to be whatever it is, and they need to do things about assessment. And so they got a little bit better towards the end about assessment and the things they needed to do. They just weren't real good about making decisions yet. The noise was a bit much. If you asked, what about the groups that are given the information one still at a time? Let me cut down some of the noise level. Let me guide you a little bit more and look at their performance. And you can see that using the audience response system, slowing things down for them, you are helping them a little bit more in their critical thinking skills. The process will definitely help them in a pinch say, okay, I've got a cookbook that I've got to work from. If these things are present, this is what I need to do. And they get better about gathering their information. And so in the audience response, they all did better than in simulation. And I think that that's one of the things that we'll show you that can definitely help in critical thinking. We separate the cases by about 7 to 10 weeks, and we repeat them. They've seen them. They've been debriefed on them. They talked about what actually happened. And you put them back into simulation, and they did pretty well. This, the sim one, case one, is a tough sim. We knew that that was a hard one. I think if you waited another 7 weeks, our hope is that they get very good at identifying that. This was an accidental extubation. It just looked too easy, and they would have never thought that that was the case, and they should have picked up on it. I think in 7 weeks they'll do much better. But the take-home message is the simulation group actually did better in some of these than the ARS bit. One of the things that you should know about the group that's in the simulation, this is group effort. This is the group think, if you would. And in the group, you're going to have strong students and weak students, and the stronger students will actually dominate the group effort. Usually you hope that that happens. You hope that the weak students won't encourage the students to do wrong things. But I think that that's one of the things that we see here. The stronger students in the group can predominate and help you in critical thinking. That too is important in critical thinking because you're teaching students the reasoning. The Men in Black clip where, as a student, he's standing back and he's saying, "That was a nice shot. What, you know, I might have done these things wrong," but it's the interaction amongst his peers that tries to give feedback. And feedback is important in multiple ways. It's important when they get feedback from their faculty, but I think feedback is still important from peers, and that's one of the things that happens in simulation. It definitely is added to by having had the audience response system where they've broken things down one clip at a time. So if we look at audience response 7 weeks later, again, the performance is better than it was at the beginning, and I think better still. So I think one of the things that we can get from the use of clickers is a way of enhancing a technology that we have, the use of simulation, to improve critical thinking. And at that, I'll stop. I know that that probably was a bit fast, but it's late in your afternoon, and so maybe I'll take questions if you have any. Yes, ma'am. And so one of the things that we've done, I think that that's good, that you could assign roles. And we haven't assigned roles. We let them go in the room, and we're hoping that there's going to be a predominance of stronger students. And my rationale with this is that I think that students will learn to listen to, in the first iteration, they may listen to a voice, and because the person is just louder, is more confident. And then when they find that the response wasn't the appropriate response, the person who was somewhat quieter, who probably knew the right answer but hesitated, will become stronger. And so that's our rationale for not assigning roles, is I'd like to try to develop that. And I think simulation is a good way to try to do that. That's hard to do in the clinic, and I don't know that I necessarily would do that in the clinic. In the clinic, I probably do assign roles, and knowing that I have people that have different strengths. But I think simulation lets us do that. And what we've seen, the young lady who had her hands over her face, probably one of our stronger students. Emotion at that point got a little bit the best of her, and as she's done better, she's taken more of a lead role. In some of the other simulations, instead of hanging back, she's up front. She realized her skills and she saw where she was. Yes, sir.
Are these med students or respiratory?
These are respiratory therapy students.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I'm a pediatrician. I did my rotations in the NICU, and if something goes wrong, there's usually a group of people around that little table, and people are
offering advice.
That's right, and I think that's a good teaching method that mimics clinical medicine accurately. My question was: have you ever, from the pre and post test results, it looks like in pre the ARS group did better, and maybe that's because they're still images, they don't have the background noise, they're able to sort of think it through. Have you ever thought of ARS as kind of a transition that then would make simulation even better? So in other words, you do ARS first, then you test those same students on simulation and see if they, like simulation plus ARS, would do better than either one.
Absolutely. And that's one of the, and so as we did this, one of the reasons for assigning the clickers and looking at group performance, because, you know, the simulation group here wasn't necessarily the, now when you ask this ARS group, so their roles had reversed. And so if you asked, because we looked at teams, were there stronger teams, and does that help? I think that is a way to go. I think the stills are a way of slowing down. Let me show you what, since you asked. That's a very good question. And I'm going to show you, basically, I didn't want you to use your clickers, but to give you an idea of what the questions were. These are just four questions that were in the sim. And so the screens that they would have gotten. So they get information that says, here's what you see. These are the things that are there. Now to your question, we gave them a drop-down menu. Here are your choices. the idea of the things that they should try to do anyway, and the way they should be thinking in their minds as things are moving very quickly. And so we're giving them a menu to drop down from. They've been told this in all their lessons and everything, in all the didactic material that they've gotten, they just haven't had to apply it yet. And so now you're right, if you give them this as a precursor to the simulation and they follow through, it should help.
Right.
And definitely,
that's ultimately the goal. That's, you want them to be able to, okay, you have your time, think about it a little bit, but when it actually comes down to it, you want to be able to perform at the bedside.
And perform quickly and not be
distracted. I didn't use the timer.
We just went through, and actually that's funny, because one of the things that's happened is in the first instance, if I would have used the timer, it took forever. It was painful for them to become engaged. As they did it more and they had an increase in comfort level, it was moving quicker, and the timer would have been good data to have to say this is how long they've gone, and this is what they're actually doing. Yes, ma'am.
This was kind of a study, right?
Mm-hmm. That's true.
And I wonder what your thoughts about that and with the study and then the next experience in terms of, would it be better for the students to have a different scenario with the same problem?
Very good question. So let me tell you what started this. What started this for us was our credentialing exam. I'm a registered respiratory therapist by profession. Our credentialing exam, and so those of you that are clinicians probably know that, is a two-part exam. One part of the exam is an exam that's called the clinical simulation exam. It's all on computer, but the students are given 11 different patients that they gather information on, and then they have to make decisions based on that information. The national first-time pass rate for that exam is about 60%. And what kills students isn't the information, and there's two parts. There's an information gathering part that they get assessed on, and a decision-making part that they get assessed on all these 11 patients. The information gathering, they do well on. We have a society, a generation of students that know how to surf the net, and they gather tons of information. They just don't know what to do with it when they get it, which is sad, but it's something that we can definitely address. And so that was our reason for addressing this. In this exam that they take, they also get, of these 10 patients that they get one neonatal patient. So we can collect the data from our testing agency that says what's performance on that. The performance on decision making for the neonatal patient was the pass rate for our students was about 60%. Said another way, about 40% weren't doing very well with decision making on that particular patient. They could still pass the exam without having to pass the neonatal bit, but we thought if that's the data that we've had historically for our students, can we now add this to our curriculum and improve their decision-making, their critical thinking scores? And we think that the answer is yes. And where I'll get the data, already I see, and you're right, it would be nice to have other types of patients. The reason for us picking these patients is that typically for the credentialing agency, they're gonna see a baby who's a meconium aspiration, or they're gonna see a baby that they have to resuscitate. They'll see a premature baby. And that was our reason for picking these types of patients, because is it just recall? Because in the past, we've given them all the information. They've done computer simulations, they had that. And if recall were the only issue, you would think that their performance would have been much, much better, that the pass rate would be better than what it is. Because I think our students' ability to recall is a lot greater than we give them credit for. I think one of the things that happens is that they can recall specifics, and they can recall, I've seen a meconium aspiration, or I've seen this. They just don't do good about putting the little pieces of data together that are, you know, connecting those dots. And I think that this helps, and just repeated practice with that is important. I think we, go ahead.
I'm just gonna comment. I think some of what is important about clinical medicine, though, is recall. I mean, what you want your, just like with my med students, I mean, you want them to be able to recognize the same pattern, especially when they're this inexperienced.
Absolutely.
Even if, you know, they're gonna see that, they're gonna see an accidentally extubated child multiple. So they do need to see the same thing. If you were teaching a microbiology class, then if they remembered the exact same question, it might not be, you know, it might be a bit more of a problem.
Right.
But I think, again,
it's
clinical medicine, it's, you know.
It's that. And so the cases that we've picked on is because we picked the accidental extubation, the right main intubation, the pneumothorax, they're going to present almost the same. There are very distinct things that they have to be able to pick up. You know, now, when they said this, one of the, I think, which would you do first? Assess the patient. They were all over the place with this in their first instance. They were wanting to do, because they got this. And so the for each of the cases that we have, the frames are almost the same. They're almost identical. The vital signs are almost the same. The endotracheal tube position is a little different. For sure, the right main intubation is the tubes almost all the way down into the baby. For the extubation, the tube's almost hanging out. And it should be the most obvious that they would pick up. But the other things, you know, present almost the same. In this first bit, they were all over the place about what they would do. Now, without a doubt, they recall that the first thing they have to do is assess the patient ventilator system. And in that process, yeah, they recall that, they remember it, and I want them to. And then they're gonna do better about, I think, collecting information with that.
How much is four, by the way?
You would choose four? And you would be surprised how many had picked that. It's like, or, you know, that. Yeah. Other questions? Your input is good. And so your answer is, the answer to your question is, where are we going to go next? In 6 months, we should be able to collect the data on this group that says our students have to be registered as a condition of graduation. Most of our students are registered in their penultimate semester, which is the spring. So in the spring, they'll be taking their registry exam, and we'll collect the data that says, here was your performance on these neonatal patients. And if things work out like we want, I think that our performance on this group will be better. It's an N of one, and there could be a lot of other reasons for the performance to be better. We have the historical data that says, you know, we've always had classes perform at this, and then we'll continue. And I think that when we do two classes, the problem is we have small classes. It takes 2 years to put them out, so the power of the study is going to be limited. I think the observation will be an important one, and I think it's a way of utilizing clinical simulation. I think it's, well, because for all of our testing agencies, they're going to be tested in a way that they're going to, you know, be given the information. And so we do them a disservice by not providing them questions in the way that they're going to see them. And so I think in doing this, we make our students better test takers, and I think we make them better clinicians, which to me is the bottom line. I could care less if they're good test takers. I want them to be successful, but I want them to be better in the clinical setting. And I think this will help them be better in the clinical setting. It's either very late or I bothered you terribly. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Just sorry, not Dominic, but I can see other applications of this. If you think about advanced cardiac life support or pediatric advanced life support, these courses where we're supposed to do simulations, and especially for the recertification courses where everybody gets a role, but not everybody's doing everything.
Right.
But if you incorporate the ARS question, say before, in a session before the simulation, you give everybody a chance to have to think, to force them to think it through themselves instead of being the person at the back of the, or mock codes.
Right.
For example.
And actually, we see that.
And then you would enhance their, I mean, even if they didn't get a chance to participate, you would at least enhance.
You could evaluate how they did.
Yeah.
And so newbie comes with the NRP protocols that are there. We've just gotten approval for budget money for Sim Junior, which is, you know, would be the PALS bit. We have our Sim Man. We don't have the ALS protocols, but programming isn't that difficult. But again, that's a step that we'd like to go. And it's a shared resource. I think it's one of the things that we can do amongst all of our professions. And that's one of the things that we're trying to do in Galveston, is share the limited resources that we have so that we have nursing students, respiratory students, med students all working together. And a better use of resource, I think. Other questions? Yeah, thank you again for your time, and thank Turning Technologies for inviting me.